Hi everyone, it's Danielle with North Lawn Flower Farm, and today I want to share with you the best cut flowers for shade. And this is a video that has been highly requested, and I can completely understand why. We're constantly being told that cut flowers need full sun. And while that is true of a lot of cut flowers, there are still an abundance of shade-loving or shade-tolerant flowers that we can use for cutting. So let me share that list with you. The first flower on my list is Bleeding Heart. And Bleeding Heart is a beautiful spring-blooming perennial that comes in pink, red, white, and provides a beautiful draping texture in an arrangement. It's easily propagated by division. So if you have a friend or relative that has Bleeding Heart in their garden, it would be easy to acquire a small piece just to start your patch. Bleeding Heart is considered a spring ephemeral, meaning that it blooms early in the season and then dies back to the ground in midsummer. So don't be alarmed if by August your Bleeding Heart is nowhere to be found. That's normal, and it will reappear next spring. Now, as a cut flower, I especially love to pair Bleeding Heart with late daffodils, tulips, peonies, and lilacs. I think it really brings a lot of old-world charm to an arrangement, as well as giving the bouquet a garden-grown feel. Next on my list is Columbine, and Columbine is one of the true joys of the spring woodland garden. They have charming, furnished leaves and blooms that come in a wide range of colors. They really say heirloom flower to me and add that bit of charm and whimsy that I love in design work. For cutting, I would recommend the taller varieties, such as the Barlow series. Columbine is easily grown from seed, so establishing a drift of Columbine shouldn't cost more than a packet of seeds and some tender, loving care. Now you want to harvest Columbine when a third to a half of the flowers on the stem have opened, and it will give you a vase life of approximately 6 days. Next on my list is the hellebore, and this clump-forming perennial is one of the earliest flowers to bloom in my garden, and the foliage even stays evergreen. They come in lovely muted shades of eggplant, mauve, ivory, green, rose, and more. They can be single or double flowers, and many have streaking and speckles on their petals. It's easy to see why these flowers have become increasingly popular over the last few years with both gardeners and florists alike. Wait until the seed pods have begun to form before you pick their beautiful blooms. Next up on my list is a stilbe, and if you love the look of flowers like celosia or amaranth but don't have full sun, go with an astilbe instead. It will still provide you with those wonderful fluffy spike blooms without needing the full sun. Astilbe comes in white, purple, pink, red, and even peach. Since there are a wide range of cultivars, be sure to select a tall variety when it comes to cutting. A longer stem on any flower will always give you the most versatility in terms of arranging. And the longer the stem, the more valuable the cut flower is. We want to harvest a stilbe when the entire bloom stalk is showing color and 3/4 of the flowers are open on the stem. Next up on my list is Lady's Mantle, and I love Lady's Mantle as both a garden perennial and as a cut flower. It's personally very special to me because both my grandmother and my mother grew loads of Lady's Mantle in their gardens. As a garden specimen, nothing beats their gray-green leaves that perfectly collect water droplets. And as a cut flower, their chartreuse spikes of glittering green blooms are truly unmatched. Even if you're not interested in cut flowers, I think you would enjoy having a drift of Lady's Mantle in your garden. Harvest the Lady's Mantle blooms when 3/4 of the flowers on a stem are open. I have personally found these blooms to be incredibly long-lasting. At least a full week in the vase can be expected. Next on my list is Japanese anemone. And Japanese anemone is a fall-blooming perennial that will give you loads of pink, purple, and white satiny blooms. I just love how their bloom stalks sway peacefully in the breeze. And since they're a bit late to rise in the garden, they make an ideal ground cover for the dying foliage of spring bulbs. Next up on my list is Solomon Seal. And for a foliage that thrives in part to full shade, I feel like Solomon Seal just can't be beat. Now, although Solomon Seal does produce white flowers along its stem that look much like Lily of the Valley, it's really all about the foliage, in my opinion. Solomon Seal comes in standard green, but check out the variegated white and green cultivar for a more sophisticated and versatile cut. You want to harvest the foliage at ground level, and you can expect a vase life of 7 to 10 days. Next on my list is the Heuchera. And the Heuchera gives us two things, a wonderful short cut with different color foliage, and also some bloom spikes that add some natural sparkle and whimsy into an arrangement. There are many interesting colors to choose from, such as butterscotch, burgundy, lime green, and more. For foliage, cut the stems at ground level, and for blooms, cut when half the florets on a stem are open. Now let's move on to shrubs that thrive in either full to part shade and provide us with buckets of blooms with almost no care at all on our part. Now the first on my list has to always be the big leaf hydrangea, also known as a mophead hydrangea or microphylla hydrangea. These lovely shrubs provide us with literally armloads of flowers on each shrub. In my zone 6B, where the winters are bitterly cold, but the summers are very hot and humid, I find that these shrubs prefer a bit of morning sun and enjoy afternoon shade. I have a few older big leaf hydrangeas on our property, and I'm unsure of the cultivar, but over the last few years, I've been adding some reblooming varieties to my stock, and I was completely blown away by their floral performance. The Let's Dance Rave series in particular provided me with more blooms than I've ever experienced on a newer big leaf hydrangea cultivar before. The shrub was completely covered in blooms, and since it's a reblooming hydrangea, I continue to receive blooms into the fall. Big leaf hydrangeas are long-lasting cut flowers that can create truly spectacular floral displays. For the longest vase life, be sure to harvest big leaf hydrangeas early in the morning when the plant is well hydrated. Cut only when the blooms are fully colored and mature. Remove most of the foliage, make an angled cut to the stem, then cut vertically up, and immediately place in water to condition for 12 to 24 hours. I've done a complete guide on these beauties as cut flowers that I'll link in the description section. Next on my list is the oakleaf hydrangea, and I'm particularly passionate about oakleaf hydrangeas because they're native to North America and they have the most beautiful shaped leaves and also wonderful fall color. These hydrangeas are considered to be the most shade tolerant of all hydrangeas, and whenever I see a mature hedge of oakleaf hydrangeas, my breath is always taken away by their beauty. The variety I have in my garden is called Gatsby Gal, which has a semi-dwarf habitat, topping out at about 6 by 6 feet tall and wide. I've also asked my girlfriend, who owns the local nursery, to hold a Gatsby Moon hydrangea for me to purchase. This one has big, full, almost mophead blooms, and I want to dry a lot of them for our dried floral Christmas tree this year. Now, for the longest vase life, cut the oakleaf hydrangea blooms when they have begun to turn their antique green, almost pink fall color. Now, you can cut them in the ivory stage, but they will last significantly longer when more mature. Next on my list, and one I'm very excited to share with you, is the rhododendron. And I'm so excited to talk about rhododendron as a cut flower because I almost never see it listed in cut flower gardening books or floral design books, and I'm not sure why. I started to do my own trials on rhododendron about 4 years ago, and what I noticed was absolutely amazing. Picked when half the florets on a head were open, I was easily getting 10 days of vase life. I found that picking in full bud was also successful, or picking fully open for an event worked also. I have three older pink varieties in our front garden, and this year I'm adding one with striking foliage color as well. It's called Black Hat, and it has purple black foliage that I think will bring another special element into an arrangement. But no matter what kind of rhododendron you decide to pick for the vase, I would encourage you to just go ahead and pick it. To me, it's really the hydrangea of spring and worthy of more use in floral design. Now, next on my list is the azalea. And after trialing the rhododendron here in our garden and finding out that it was such a wonderful cut flower, I quickly started to trial the azalea as well. And much to my excitement, it held almost just as well as the rhododendron, at least 7 days in the vase. You want to go ahead and harvest the azalea for blooms when half the blooms on a cluster are open. And for foliage, harvest when the leaves are leathery and firm. If you struggle with lace bug on your azaleas, and I certainly do struggle with lace bug on my older varieties, check out the Perfecto series that is resistant to lace bug. For me, this was really a game changer, as I've always found it very hard to deal with lace bugs organically. By selecting lace bug resistant varieties, I can skip the headache of dealing with those bad bugs and just enjoy the azalea blooms. Now I'm ending our list with Pieris japonica, an evergreen shrub that has blooms on it that almost look like dangling jewels. It's really quite spectacular to see. I've heard this shrub sometimes called Lily of the Valley shrub, and most of the older varieties are quite tall and have white blooms, but there are also some new varieties like Interstella that have ruby blooms and stay more compact at 4 by 4 feet tall. So select a shrub that's best suited for your desired site in the landscape. I have found Pieris to be incredibly shade tolerant and also deer resistant. Now, at least in my area, they are slow growing. So for cutting, take just what you need and leave the rest in the landscape. Well, I sure hope this list of the best cut flowers for shade was helpful. If it was, and you'd like to learn more about cut flowers or gardening organically, or just like to spend some time here in my garden, would you please subscribe to my channel? I would love to get to know you better and share more of the joy of gardening with you. Until next time, happy gardening. Bye!